Welcome to Us Crazy Christians, where we uncover Christian myths and misinterpretations with common sense Christianity. I'm your host, William E. Smith, and today we're going to take a look at defeating anxiety and depression. Stick around. Now, I'm neither a doctor nor a psychiatrist, so I encourage you up front to pray about what I say. Talk to a professional and decide for yourself. I personally struggled with anxiety and depression for many years, and it almost killed me. I was able to get free from them and to help others get free as well. As a matter of fact, it was some of those other people who encouraged me to make this video. So I pray that I'm able to help you defeat anxiety and depression as well. Check this out. Poor William. Remember the other day when you walked up to that pretty girl at the gym and you asked for a phone number and she yelled out and ran away, "Ugh, get away from me!" I know that was a little embarrassing, but I mean, you brought that on yourself. You knew she wasn't in your level. Why would you even try to talk to her? I'm just keeping it real with you. You know you're worthless. Hey, but you shouldn't be shocked. Your grandma told you you were never gonna be nothing. And she said, that's why you bite your nails, remember? Oh yeah, that reminds me. Remember when you were in school, in elementary school, and you had diarrhea and you just didn't make it to the bathroom on time? So boo-boo ran all down your legs. What was that nickname the other kids was calling you in school? I'm trying to remember what that... Oh, I remember. The Dookie King. Ooh. You know I had to remind you of that. Because that's what friends are for. And I'm your buddy, William. Dog, you don't never do nothing right. You worthless, come on. You a horrible parent. You ruined your kids' lives. You know you worthless. You a little light-skinned, weak bitch, just like your stepdaddy said you were. The world will be better off without you. Kill yourself, nigga. Wow. Anxiety is worrying about something that may go wrong or any uncertain outcome. It can also be a constant, uneasy feeling with anxiety. Depression is feelings of despondency, dejection, and misery. And I struggled with them both. At the height of my depression and suicidal thoughts, all it would take is one negative thought to come to mind. Then I would start to dwell on that thought. And sooner or later, a bunch of other negative thoughts would just pile on top of that one. And in no time flat, I began to feel like my life was useless. And I should just kill myself. Then one day I heard a pastor say that the devil comes to us and gives us bad thoughts. And that they are not our thoughts, but they are the devil giving us these bad thoughts, so it's not us. And that helped me a lot. At least it helped me get away from trying to kill myself. Because it gave me an adversary to focus on and to blame. While I was fighting with the devil, I wasn't able to focus on my sadness or my anxiety or my depression. Because I had an enemy to focus on. I'd be in spiritual warfare, talking in tongues, binding and loosing, tearing down strongholds, etc. till I was exhausted. It was a release for me. So for many years, when I would go into deep depression or anxiety, I would immediately go into spiritual warfare with the devil, and that would bring me out of my funk. But it was always temporary. The devil would always come back. Then I would be full of anxiety and depression all over again. Then one day, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5, jumped out at me. It talked about casting down every imagination and high thought that goes against what God says about us, and bringing every thought into the obedience of Christ. And I felt for the first time that maybe I could control this. So I began to quote it as often as I could remember to. I would share it with other people until it became a part of me. Then I began to see other verses that complemented the first one, like Philippians 4 and 8. Fix your thoughts on what is true, honorable, and pure. Whatever is lovely, good, honorable, whatever is of good report. If there is any virtue, if there is anything praiseworthy, think on these and meditate on these. I begin to notice my life changing right before my eyes. And it honestly did not take a very long time. As my faith in these verses grew, so did my freedom. In the skit we did at the beginning, did you notice how the devil looked just like William? That was because it was me. My mind was just giving me more of what it believed I wanted. I was constantly thinking negative thoughts, so my mind gave me more of what it assumed I wanted, what I was focusing on. Devil means accuser. Satan means adversary. Maybe I was my own accuser and adversary. Jesus rebuked Peter by saying, "Get thee behind me, Satan." But we are so used to blaming somebody else for our actions, we immediately jump to the conclusion that the devil must have crawled up into one of Jesus' disciples and was speaking through him. But scripture doesn't even hint that something like that happened. Peter was being an adversary to what Jesus was trying to do, and Jesus simply called him out for what he was. He said, "Get thee behind me, adversary." Now, I'm not saying that a literal Satan doesn't exist. We'll do a separate video on that later. As a matter of fact, hit the notifications bell to be notified when we let that video go and when we do any other videos. Choose to see the cup half full as opposed to half empty. Our minds are our servants, and they serve us by helping us acquire the things that we focus on, good or bad. Our minds don't judge our thoughts. They just bring us what we focus on. So choose to focus on positive thoughts. Now, this isn't coming from 2 William chapter 2. I'm giving Bible to prove these points. There are a lot of scriptures that support this. Let me give you some more. Believe that you received it and you shall have it, good or bad. Speak those things that be not as though they were already. You shall have what you say. Be it unto you according to your faith. All of those scriptures are confirming that when you speak, negative or positive, and when you believe in that which you're focusing on, that is what it's going to give you. Good or bad to you. It wasn't until I realized that it was me causing those thoughts that I was truly able to be free from depression and anxiety. Once I realized that I had the ability to fix these issues myself, my life completely changed, and yours can too. My late pastor, Reggie Lane in Detroit, used to say, "You never get what you desire, you only get what you focus on." And at the time, I didn't really understand all the wisdom that he was saying, but now I truly get what he was talking about. We may desire or want nice things, but we only get what we focus on. So focus on joy, peace, health, prosperity, provision. Have gratitude for even the small good things in your life. A lot of us think that repent means to cry out to God for forgiveness, but that's not what it means. As a matter of fact, I plan to do a separate video breaking that down. Again, hit the notifications bell so you know when we release that video. But repent is metanoia. It means change your mind or a change of mind. The prevalent idea was to change your thinking. The words repent, repentance, or repented are mentioned over 100 times in the Bible. That shows you how much and how important it is to change your way of thinking. The scripture is, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. Good or bad is up to you. The one is, as a man thinks in his heart, so is he. Good or bad thoughts? There's a scripture that says, cast your cares upon him. Cast means to throw, and cares mean worries. So we are to throw our worries to God. God won't take your worries from you, but he will receive them from you if you throw them to him. And he doesn't want you to be gentle and nice about it. He said, throw them. Throw them. The same thing with casting down every negative thought. He tells us to get rid of them, to throw them away from us with force. Last one, be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. In other words, change the way you are thinking and your life will be changed. Again, this is not 2 William chapter 2. This is the Bible. Change your thoughts inside and it will change your world outside. A lot of times we pray for God to fix things for us, but he has already given us the ability and free will to fix them for ourselves. As a matter of fact, remember Noah? God didn't deliver Noah and his family from the flood. He told Noah to go build this boat, go get you some nails, some hammers, and some wood or whatever, and you build this boat so you and your family don't die. God didn't magically take his hands from heaven and scoop Noah and his family up over the waters through his fingers. They could see the waters. He says, see how I have delivered thee. And they just looking down at all the water. No, he said, go build a boat. You build a boat, you'll be saved. Maybe that's the same thing he's telling us. He has given us dominion. He has given us control, the ability to cast down our thoughts, to change our mind, to repent. He wouldn't ask us to do it. He wouldn't tell us to do it if we couldn't do it. But imagine if God did just reach into our mind and into our hearts and deliver us. The problem with that would be is that because we never changed our minds, we would simply just bring those negative thoughts that cause anxiety and depression right back to us. We have to change our mind in order to keep those things away from our lives. God would do us an injustice by coming down and fixing it for us, only to have us in a worse state later. The best thing he could do is what he did. You fix it yourself. You cast down those thoughts. You throw those thoughts down. You repent and turn and think a different way. The Bible says that we reap what we sow. So if we are planting sad memories or sad thoughts, we will reap sad memories and sad thoughts. If we plant, if we sow good memories and good thoughts, we will reap good memories and good thoughts. Sowing and reaping is not bias. It doesn't decide to only give us good. It will give us good or bad, whatever we want to plant. We are the ones who plant. If we plant worries and fears of the future, we will reap more worries and fears of the future. That's the epitome of anxiety. If you want a harvest of love, joy, peace, success, then you have to plant those seeds. We have all the power. Let me give you a few positive affirmation scriptures that you should probably try to repeat as often as you can, every time you can remember, all day, while you're driving, while you're in the car. Write them down on something, put them on your dashboard, put them on your cell phone while you're at work, and just say these scriptures over and over again to you. You can use a lot of ones I've already mentioned. I'm about to give you some more. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Another one is, I am more than a conqueror through Christ Jesus. And another one, I am an overcomer through Christ Jesus. Don't, even if you just start saying those right now, you could almost instantly begin to feel yourself feeling better if you're just repeating what I just said. It's awesome. Nothing shall by any means hurt me. And my favorite, I say this every day, all day. All things work together for my good. That means no matter what happens, what's going on right now, I'm in the middle of something bad, I immediately say, all things work together for my good. Even this, right now, whatever it is, works for my good. My past mistakes, my failures, everything, all my shortcomings that would have me depressed and sad, the ways I raised my kids that I didn't do good enough, my being a bad husband, how my life isn't where I wanted to be financially, all those things that would cause anxiety and depression and sadness. I look at it now like all of that, every mistake works together for my good. That is the epitome of having the last laugh on the devil and life. If bad thinking has a snowball effect and continues and amplifies throughout the day, piling on more and more negative thoughts, more and more negative experiences, then shouldn't it be the exact same in reverse? As a matter of fact, let me say, it is the exact same in reverse. If you start your day off positive, with positive thoughts, positive imaginations, consciously thinking positive, that same snowball effect happens in the positive. More positive thoughts will come, more positive experiences throughout your day. Start your day off thinking positive. Start off being grateful. Everything good in your life, big or little. Be grateful that you've made it to see a brand new day. Be grateful that you can stand and walk. Be grateful that you slept in a bed as opposed to a cardboard box under a bridge. But say you did wake up in a cardboard box and you slept in a cardboard box last night. Be grateful that at least you had a cardboard box to sleep in to keep the elements off you. It is a choice. Choose to think positive. Find things to be grateful for and watch your thoughts begin to snowball throughout the day in that same direction. You control this. It doesn't control you. When you actively choose to think more positive thoughts, you draw more positive thoughts and situations to you. Anxiety and depression cannot survive under those circumstances. Put anxiety and depression in an atmosphere they cannot, breathe in and suffocate them out. It's time to kill those negative thoughts. God has given us all we need to be successful against depression and anxiety. Sometimes I wonder if I might be just a little too transparent on this channel, but my life is like two different Williams. I contemplated suicide continually in my teens. I had a very volatile and horrible temper most of my life. But now, people can't even believe me when I tell them that. They think I'm lying or exaggerating. And I love that. I fought to become this William. And I still got a long way to go and I'm still growing. But I'm nothing like I used to be. It was like lifting weights in the gym. It was a struggle at first. I could only speak positive things. I had a very little faith, like the Bible says, a grain of mustard seed. And I was hoping that more faith would come. But until then, I just kept curling the weight. But just like lifting weights in the gym, my mind was the same way. Like when I would first go to the gym and I started lifting weights, I could only get a 5-pound weight and maybe curl it one or two times, and I had to put it down. But the more I kept going back to that weight, eventually I can get it up to 10 times, 15 times, 20 times. Then eventually 5 pounds wasn't enough for me. I had to go get a 10-pound weight, then a 20-pound, a 30-pound, etc. I realized that my mental muscles were the exact same way. I can only curl a little bit at first, but the more I keep pressing the weight, the easier it became. The more things I could change, the more I could press, the more joy and peace and good thoughts I can believe, the easier it became. So now that you realize that you have the ability to repent or to change your mind yourself, in essence, that means that you can have good days, good thoughts at will. No matter what negative thing happens in a day, you can still make your day great. You are a creator just like your father, and you create the world around you. We are only slaves to our thoughts and emotions because we have allowed ourselves to be slaves to them. But we have always had the ability to focus them, to change them, or focus them on whatever we want them to be on. Whatever muscle we use the most will be the strongest. Which muscle are you going to use? Negativity or positivity? It's up to you. The Bible says the truth shall make you free. You have just been given the truth. You are now free from anxiety and depression. The choice is yours. When you are thinking good thoughts, you feel good. And when you're thinking bad thoughts, you feel bad and full of anxiety, depression, and sadness. I promise you that you can feel relief almost immediately. That happened to me. That's what helped my faith to grow, because it didn't change my whole life, but in those moments of saying some of those positive things, of just speaking them, I felt glimpses of peace, glimpses of joy, glimpses of release. It was almost like a drug. It just made me want more. Let me do more. Let me speak more. And sometimes it was tough and I really didn't feel anything, but you just have to keep pushing through. So it's just like in a gym. Sometimes in a gym, you're working out, you don't see no change. You're working out, you're crunching, and you don't see nothing. But you keep doing it, you're gonna look up, and now you got a six-pack. If you continue thinking positive thoughts, they will eventually become second nature. Just like your anxiety, depression, and negative thoughts are second nature right now. Freedom is yours right now, but you have to seize it. I challenge you to try it and see for yourself. I pray this helps somebody, and please share this video on your social media and with somebody you know that battles anxiety and depression. If you want to see more from Us Crazy Christians, please subscribe to the channel, hit the notifications bell to be notified every time we post a new video. Hit the like button on this video, share the channel, leave a comment. Thank you very much for watching Us Crazy Christians. I appreciate you taking the time. Until next time, be blessed.